A very good afternoon and a warm welcome to one and all present over here for the webinar. To begin with the webinar, I would like everyone to have a glance to our college facilities and its infrastructure and much more details about the college. So our college name is KJ Somai Institute of Engineering and Information Technology. It is situated in Sion, Mumbai. We have our college pioneer as Padma Bhushan late Pujya Shri Karamshi Bhai Somaya, late Dr. Shantilal Somaya and Shri Samir Somaya. We have our Vidyavya administrators as Lieutenant General Jagbir Singh and Professor Rajashrekharan Pillai. The Principal and Vice Principal of KJ Somaya Institute of Engineering and Information Technology are Dr. Suresh Shukrande, Principal, and Dr. Sunita Patil, Vice Principal. The vision and mission of KJ Somaya Institute of Engineering and IT is to emerge quality and excellence and commitment in the field of engineering and provide the student a thorough knowledge of engineering and refine their professional skills. Our college is approved by AICTE and it is permanently affiliated
Anushka.
To the University of Mumbai.
अनुष्का, वो पीपीटी का ये डिस्प्ले कर दे, पीपीटी का दिस वन है, यस
सॉरी.
हाँ कंटिन्यू कंटिन्यू.
Our college is approved by AICTE and it is permanently affiliated to University of Mumbai. Ma'am, would you like to, can you please admit the participants when they're in the meeting room?
Myself?
Hello?
Myself?
Yes, ma'am. I have made you the
host. Okay. Yes. You continue. Yes. I will do the continue.
The programs offered by our college are BTech, a BE in Computer Engineering, Information Technology, Electronics Engineering, Electronics and Telecommunication, Artificial Intelligence and Data Science, and ME in Artificial Intelligence with different intakes. We have our inspiring ambience as open air canteen, amphitheater, sports arena, playing fields, and etc. We have a spacious seminar hall and auditorium within the campus itself. We have our huge library with also a digital access to all the resources, also with 40 laboratories with modern equipments and software. The silent offering at KJ Somaya is software development cell, Riddle, research innovation incubation, design lab center, and much more. Awards and recognition to KJSIIT in yesteryears as best college awarded by University of Mumbai for the academic year 2018 and 19. It is also awarded as best institute of the year by the CSI for the year of 2018 and 19. It was also awarded as best engineering college by ISTE for the year 2018, and many much awards were given to this institute. Our college faculty has also received many awards. The recent research and innovation at KJSIIT are mobile application called Kisan Khazana for farmers, development of upper air sounding system by our college students itself, and many more, as you can see on the slide. Our curriculum education is outcome-based education, project-based learning, online-offline blended teaching learning, online assessment, etc. We conduct 150+ seminars, webinars, workshops, SDPs, training programs, etc. every year. Industry interaction and placements. We have high recruiting companies such as Human Resourcia, Jaro Education, MU Sigma, LTI, Amazon, Reliance Jio, and etc. We have many different co-curricular activities within our college campus. We also have our technical and cultural fest named as Surge and Renaissance. There are different student clubs and cell for students to interact and enhance their qualities, such as NSS, programming club, hobby club, New Leap initiative, Robocon cell, my very own COEPS cell, R&D cell, and much more. The recent trumps of our KJSIIT is we won first prize in Smart India Hackathon in 2019. We also won first prize in Mastec Deep Blue Project Competition in 2020, Season 5, and many more. Thank you.
Anushka?
Yes, ma'am.
Apte sir is waiting in waiting room. You please check that.
Ma'am, no one is waiting in the waiting room, I guess. I'll disable the waiting room only.
Haan,
na? Yeah, I did that. But sir is not there.
Okay, I will call to...
Once again, a very warm good afternoon and welcome to everyone present over here in the webinar. I really appreciate you all for joining me here today. To begin with, I would like to introduce myself. I am Anushka Jain, pursuing BE in Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering from esteemed KJS Homai Institute of Engineering and Information Technology. Our college has been accredited by NAC with A grade. We have also been awarded as the best college by the University of Mumbai, ISTE and CSI. Considering me as a part of the COEPS cell, I would like to drive everyone to the glimpse of our committee's event and achievements. The COEPS cell is known to have conducted lots of internships, including the railway internship and lots of exciting events and webinars. Till now, under COEPS cell, around 287 students have completed their internship and hands-on life projects at Nehru Science Center and much more till date. Through this journey of every event, we have been abiding by the COEPS cell motto. We, the cell, will educate the student about the opportunities in public sector to achieve a good career and serve the society for its betterment. I would like to drive the attention of the audience to this webinar conducted by a cell in association with Indian Women Scientists Association, VASHI, on importance of quality in service and service networking by Mr. Alhad Apte. The program is aimed onto how and why is the service networking affected by its quality. The webinar will also be known to introduce many interesting facts and knowledge. This is an easy system for boosting our self-esteem and visibility. Without spinning out wheels much, let's begin with the webinar. I would like Mrs. Mahajan from IWSA to give a little much introduction about the Indian Women Scientists Association.
Hello, everybody. Anushka, you please later. Thank you. Can
everybody hear me? Oh, ma'am, your voice
can
is
hear
breaking.
Me?
Your voice is breaking.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Hello?
Hello?
Hello, Anuna, can you hear me?
Ma'am, we can hear you, but your voice is breaking.
I welcome Ms. Apte to here join. I'm very happy. Hello, Anushka. Can you all hear me?
Hello.
I हेलो मैम, माजन मैम,
हेलो.
हाँ, योर वॉइस इज नॉट कमिंग क्लियरली.
हेलो,
कैन यू हियर? यस यस मैम, यस कंटिन्यू.
सो आई वुड लाइक टॉक अ लिटिल बिकॉज आई थिंक मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम मिस्टर आपेल आवर इंडियन Indian Women's Scientists a group of
women scientists came together
and in 1973 and decided to have a platform for women scientists. So they started the Indian Women Scientists Association. And now it has gone over to 2,500 members. There are 11 branches: Amravati, Baroda, Bangalore, Delhi, Hyderabad, Kalpakkam, Kollapur, Nagpur, Pune, Roorkee, and Nellore. Please, second slide, please. And we all started with a objective of taking science to masses and specially developing scientific temper in the society. And in those days, women in science had lots of problems, so understanding their problems plus sharing the knowledge and professional competence and to be a representative body of women in science and technology. The main aim is promote scientific accomplishments among women scientists and develop scientific temper to the society. Next slide, please. And this is done in can be grouped under two categories: community welfare projects and science education programs. Community welfare projects are, we first of all built a working women's hostel for 150 girls and started a nursery school, which is going on still fine, very well. Daycare center, there were about 30 students, but now it has been closed due to COVID. And community healthcare center. Then we have a computer center also and a library. We hold various cancer detection camp and other healthcare checkups. And all this is taken, the people who attend it are scientists, engineers, experts, educationists, researchers, college teachers. For science education program, we have Science Nurture Initiative, science workshops for students, parents and teachers, Sunday Science Club, where we teach the young school children and they gain quite a lot from our expertise. And we hold triennial conferences. There are seminars. We have popular science lectures are also there. And there are refresher courses for college and teachers. We have annual science exhibitions. And the last and the best is the learning garden, which is an open air laboratory also are having. So in learning garden, children can see everything there. So some of the programs organized by USA in collaboration with scientific academies and other scientific bodies are refresher course on advances of animal and plant biotechnology in February 2012. Refresher course in foundations of physics. This was very popular. 20th December 2014 to 2nd January 2015. Lecture workshop on bioinformatics, that is 6th and 7th February 2016. Lecture workshop on omics, basics and application, 8th and 9th July 2017. Refresher course on foundations of physics and chemistry and its application, 15th to 30th December. Workshop on lasers and their applications, 20 to 21st January 2018. So you can see it is a continuous list. And the last one, which is not included here, I would like to say, is we were holding a machine learning workshop in February in 2020, which was very successful. And all the faculty is experts in BRC and other scientific institutions. There is a lot of things to say, but I would stop here and give over to Anushka, please. Anushka, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I would like Sandhya, ma'am, to please give us a little introduction about Allad Apte, sir.
Thank you, Anushka. I, Sandhya Deshpande, from KJ Somaiya Engineering College, Sion, getting very pleasure to introduce our today's eminent speaker, Sri Allad Apte, sir. Sri Allad Apte, sir, completed his B.E. Electrical course in 1971 from Walton College of Engineering as a rank holder from Shivaji University, Maharashtra. He joined Bhabha Atomic Research Center, BARC, as a scientific officer in the year 1972. During the tenure in the BARC, he held important position in the BARC and served for 40 years. Computer network, cybersecurity, supercomputing, grid computing are his area of specialization. He get retirement in 2012 as an outstanding scientist and a head of computer division of BARC. He also chaired Computer and Information Security Advisory Group of Department of Atomic Energy and was instrumental in the perfecting the cybersecurity system of departmental as a model system. He received a special contribution award of Department of Atomic Energy in 2007. He undertook and completed several projects in the Department of Atomic Energy DAE level and at the highest national level, including classified national security project. He also worked on the contributed significantly to cybersecurity related to the Consultative Committee and International Atomic Energy Agency of the United Nations. He has held responsibilities in the grid computing project of CERN, Geneva and European Commission. He joined in 2012 National Technical Research Organization, NTRO, India's Technical Intelligence Agency in the Prime Minister Office under the charge of National Security Advisory. He took over as the chief of NTRO and ex-officio secretary to Government of India, the highest rank in central government from 2013 to 2015, and take a significant initiative in the efficient generation of technical intelligence for a country's national security system. He is a writer on science and keenly involved in the music. He has written several articles in the Vishwakosha of Marathi Encyclopedia of Government of Maharashtra. His Common Man book on the telecommunication in Marathi, the Sandesh Vahan, was published by the Granthali in 1998. He was authored in Marathi the widely published extensive chronicle of the atomic energy in the India, Bharatachi Anugatha, published by the Manovikas Prakashan in May 2017. He was translated in poetry form the Kirtis of the Kannada Sant Pandar Das in Marathi. A music album, Dekhele Govinda, of Purandar Das devotional song, was released in Karnataka Sangh Matunga, Mumbai in 2011. A music album, Gopal Pare of Meera Bhajan, composed by him, was released at Shivaji Park, Mumbai in March 2017. This is the introduction of our eminent speaker. So now I like to hand over the session to Apte sir. Sir, please take the session. Sir, please unmute yourself. Unmute.
Hello, am I audible now?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Very nicely. Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sandhya. And I also like to thank IWSA and BRNS, and in particular, Madam Sunita Mahajan, and Somaya Trust for giving me this opportunity to talk to the students about the subject which I had selected today is quality of service in networks. It looks a little technical subject, but it's highly relevant today. As all of us know, during this lockdown due to this pandemic, all of us are sitting at home and everybody is more and more depending on internet. Like we are having this webinar now, and we expect that our videos, our presentations, our audio should be clearly without any breaks, it should be presented to all the participants. Like that, on internet, we have a lot of content, like we watch movies, we watch serials, there are a lot of work from home. So internet is heavily loaded and our life is so much depending on internet. And how the quality of communication on internet, how it is affected by quality of service parameters. That is what we are going to see today. Although, as I mentioned, it looks a little technical, but it is a very relevant subject. I will like to share my presentation here. Shall I share? Can I share? I'm not getting that.
Yes, sir, you can share. I have already made you the co-host.
Okay. Are you getting the screen now?
Yes, your presentation is visible. Hello.
Are you?
Yes, your presentation is visible.
Okay, I myself here. Okay, so now I will start with this. We will see today importance of quality of service in networks. You can see that internet today is being used for so many applications, right from gaming and health services, education, and like video conferencing and work from home, financial transactions, entertainment industry, that every user who is using the internet services expects that the network would carry data for him very accurately in time and at the rate he wants. So that is what he expects, that network gives him the quality of service which he intends. And there are lakhs and crores of users simultaneously using internet for different types of applications. Everybody expects that he should be getting his audio, video, and all his data correctly. Quality of service of a network relates to overall performance of the network from user's point of view. This is very important. It is not from the network service provider's point of view. It has to be from user's point of view. But whether it can be measured, this is a qualitative statement, whether it can be measured quantitatively, yes. The quality of service parameters can be measured. We can set certain parameters for measuring quality of service. But the parameters depend on the type of the network. Though we are coming to internet, there are various types of networks which have been used and still are in use. So slightly going deeper, we can see network performance in terms of satisfying the service needs of all the applications. So this is the service needs of different type of applications. Every application it is to control the traffic and allocation of resources in the properly allocate the resources in the network. So what is called is network engineering in these days. Network engineering has become very important here. And first we'll have a brief look at what are different types of networks. All of us, I think students of IT and communication branch and they know computer branch, they know that there are two types of networks, circuit switch and packet switch. And among packet switch, there are two subcategories, either it is connection oriented and or connectionless. We'll just briefly look at what it is. The circuit switch network, best example is our landline telephone network or mobile telephone network using GSM, not WhatsApp or calls through Wi-Fi. But mobile telephone, when you call through normal telephone call through GSM, it uses circuit switch. What does it mean? Every time you want to talk or you want to communicate, you have to set up a call. So there is a call setup and disconnection procedure. In internet, normally when you are communicating, sending email and sending WhatsApp and all this, we don't set up a call and send. We just like that send. But in circuit switch networks, there is a call setup procedure and call dropping procedure. And the during the entire duration of the call, certain resources of the network are permanently allocated for that call. In olden days, it used to be complete end-to-end wired connection. A wire used to get connected end-to-end in the network. Nowadays, in modern networks, it is not wired, but certain particular bandwidth is permanently given to the call. Now, during telephone call, we don't all of the time speak. There are silences. At a time, only one speaker is speaking. Still, both ways, the resources are not removed. They are given, permanently given to. That is the basic feature of the circuit switch network. So in telephone network, when you talk of quality of service, you have to see certain parameters. There are two types of parameters. One is call setup related parameters, like how fast call is set up. Nowadays, many times you would have experienced that when you call through mobile, it takes 10 to 12 or 15 seconds to set up a call, which is normally not acceptable. Calls should be set up in 3 or 4 seconds, but that is one quality of service parameter. So we can say quality of service has gone down because call setup time has gone up. Similarly, wrong connection calls in the old telephone networks, they used to be very common. Now it has reduced. Call dropping is very common in mobile networks. That is basically because of mobility. And when you move from one place to another place, your call is handed over to next station and then next cell. So the call may get dropped. Now, during communication, there are quality of service parameters is voice quality, whether voice is clear, whether it's clearly audible and you can make out what other person is speaking. There are no breaks in the voice. There is no noise. There is no crosstalk. There is no echo. Especially on an international call, sometimes you may have experienced the echo. Now, we come to other type of networks. This is packet switch network, in which there is all the data is digitized. All the communication you want to send, whether it is video or audio or data, everything is digitized and converted into fixed size of fixed, not very fixed, but slightly variable, but some packets. Some packets are created and a sequence of packets is sent. And at the other end, the packets are again reassembled and you make the entire message again, rebuild the entire message. Now, this is a packet switching network and there are two types, connection oriented or connectionless. Now, I'm giving just a small example of connection oriented network where you can see two computers being connected through several nodes. Nowadays, we can find routers, they're called router. Every node, there is a router which routes the packet, incoming packets to the best possible route, outgoing route, so that finally it reaches its destination. So if a packet is going in particular route, and it is in a connection-oriented circuit, virtual circuit is set up, and the circuit is, so all the packets go via same route, but resources like bandwidth, like circuit switch network, we are seeing that bandwidth is permanently allocated. Here permanently bandwidth is not allocated and not allotted to the source. If source stops sending packets for some time, that bandwidth is reused for somebody else. So that is the difference in packet switch network. Though there is call setup and call drop, everything is there, but resources are not permanently reserved. In other type of packet network, there is no call setup procedure. Network just receives packets from the source and it takes it to the destination. But as far as network is concerned, every packet is independent. So that is the internet what we are working today. All now there is all the applications. Earlier there used to be separate TV network, separate telephone network, separate video Doordarshan network. All independent networks used to be there. Now all of them are converging onto internet. Your TV channels you can watch on internet. All the movies you can, even theaters are coming to internet. You can watch movies on internet. Even theaters which are showing in big auditorium, they also get their film through internet. So internet is becoming a convergence point for all sort of network. But this internet is a datagram type of network, that is connectionless network. Basic network treats every packet as independent entity. It doesn't relate one packet to another packet. So when you go from this, so internet has been originally designed and implemented as best effort network. What does it mean? In the old days, internet was being used mainly for emails and file transfers to start with. So internet, after it start, nearly for 20 to 30 years, most of the uses or applications on the internet used to be for communicating messages and files, transferring files and downloading files, uploading files. There used to be hardly any content which was real-time content, what they call as real-time content, like video or audio or even remote control. Or now we are hearing of Internet of Things. Internet of Things is all real-time control from somewhere. You control the equipment somewhere sitting somewhere else. So these real-time applications for almost 20, 30 years, still beginning of 21st century, they were not very widely used. So internet is best effort network, means you give me the packets, I will try my best to take the packets to the other end, but there is no guarantee. So that is the basic internet structure. Even today, it is like that. So internet is a datagram type of network, as we have seen. And the packet, every packet may take a different route. That is one aspect. Because every packet is treated independently at the time of whenever new packet comes, the router may take a decision to send it through some other route. A packet may get fragmented on the way. Suppose it arrives in somewhere and it finds packet is too big, it cannot be sent on outgoing link. It will fragment the packet in two or three parts, and then further onwards, every packet will be network may reassemble it or may not reassemble it. So that job may be left to the receiving point. And packet may not reach in order. You may send packet number 1, 2, 3, 4, but while receiving, you may receive packet 1, 5, 4, 3, any in any order. So that is the basic nature of internet. So on such a network, what parameters you expect to decide what is the quality of service? Now, quality of service on internet is defined in some certain parameters. First is throughput. Throughput is given by your what is bandwidth of the network given available to you. So if you are sending a video, you will need very high bandwidth. If you are sending audio, you will need a smaller bandwidth. If you are sending just some small commands, you may need negligible bandwidth. So throughput required, you get the received necessary throughput. If you don't get the necessary throughput, then you may not receive your video, audio, or multimedia properly. Then how much is the latency or packet delay? What the delay it takes from one end to other end or packets to reach the other end? And this is very important in case it is a interactive kind of communication, like telephone conversation or video conferencing. Somebody speaks and somebody answers. Now, if I speak or my audio video must reach the other end, a person should see it and respond, and it should come back. And when it comes back, I should not notice that it is getting delayed. it is said that if delay is more than about 150 to 200 milliseconds, you will be able to notice the delay. And sometimes you speak something, you don't get response. For you might have seen many times, and when watching news on TV, that they ask something to the end reporter, and it takes long time for the reporter to respond because delay is too much. So whether your network has provides minimum delay as required, so that you don't perceive that there is a delay in the network. Then there is packet delay jitter, means whether if delay, let delay be there, but if delay is variable, sometimes it delays by half second, sometimes by 50 milliseconds, sometimes by 3 seconds, then delay variation is there, that is called jitter. And some applications like video, they need to data to flow in a, go in a continuous flow. And so jitter becomes very important there. Then there is a loss of packets. Some applications like remote control or email and other things, you cannot tolerate loss of packets or errors. Like next is error, they are related. So loss of packets or errors, it cannot tolerate. Loss of packet in case of email, other things can be taken care by asking for retransmission. So a lost packet destination will ask source to retransmit. So it will get replenished. So that is possible, but in audio and video, it is not possible to do that because audio has to continue. It cannot wait for retransmission. So it continues. So loss of, but audio and video can tolerate some small losses of packet. Video, audio, even though some small packets are missing, you can still make out the video and still make out what somebody is speaking. But if loss of packets is more, then you will find sound is broken, like we experienced some time ago. Sound was broken. It is because too many packets are getting lost. Then last is fragmented and out of order packet. I am not taking it as a quality of service parameter as such, but it is internal, but to the user, it doesn't matter whether packets are received out of order, because the network and your computer is supposed to take care of it. So it is not perceived by the user. So I am not included in the. And breaks also are not included because it is also taken care by loss of packet and errors. So these are the 5 parameters: throughput, latency, jitter, loss of packets, and error rate. These are the important parameters for measuring quality of service on internet. This is very important from today's talk point of view. What are the parameters whether quality of service on network can be measured? Now you can see certain applications, a messaging application like email or WhatsApp. You can see that loss of packets, it is very sensitive to loss of packets and errors, but throughput and delay and jitter, it is not very sensitive. It can tolerate all those things. Interactive audio, that is like a conversation, telephone conversation, where delay and jitter is very important, and throughput and losses, they're mid-level, means low throughput it can tolerate. While video streaming, video streaming is a one way, like you are watching movies. It is not both ways. It is a video is coming from one end and being watched at the other end. There is no reverse channel. So video streaming, throughput is very required, is very high. Delay, medium delay, some delay you can tolerate so long as delay is not varied. Suppose a movie is played on some Prime Video or Netflix or somewhere, and it reaches you after 3 seconds or 4 seconds, it doesn't matter. So delay it can tolerate. But if delay varies, sometimes 1 second, sometimes 5 seconds, then it becomes unacceptable. And loss of packets, to some loss of packets it can make out. Even the receiver can fill those gaps, or even our brain can fill those gaps, but so it can tolerate some of them. Video conferencing, it's a two-way video communication, so their delay and jitter are very, very critical, and you cannot tolerate them. Throughput is of course high because it is video. Now, for example, here we are using Zoom, and where so many participants are connected here. If everybody starts his video, then network is choked. So normally we advise if somebody like me, I'm giving a webinar, I'm speaking, everybody else is listening. There's no point sense in other videos being put on the network. So we request that everybody should mute his mic and stop his camera so that bandwidth is not unnecessarily choked up. So now remote control, like remotely controlling some equipment somewhere through internet. Now the Internet of Things, now it is growing. So this remote control type of thing are going to increase in future. Their throughput is very low because only some commands are going. We don't receive any audio or video there. Delay and jitter you may not like to have, because if you give some command to some machine, you should like that it should be immediately executed without it. So if you see applications, they are either elastic type of application or inelastic type of application. That means elastic means they can tolerate all these delays and jitters. Inelastic are real-time application, they cannot tolerate. Intolerant and tolerant, again, say a similar thing. In under inelastic, they can tolerate to some extent or they cannot tolerate at all. Then non-adaptive or adaptive. So it can adapt itself to the varying. Suppose bandwidth keeps on changing suppose now we are having a video here, and during my lecture your network bandwidth keeps on changing, then if your application, Zoom application, can adjust its bandwidth so that if bandwidth is low, it can produce slightly low quality of video, low resolution video. As soon as bandwidth is high, it can put a can be either rate adaptive, like I mentioned, or delay adaptive. How delay is taken care of, we will see in a while. Some applications are very sensitive to errors, and or some applications sensitive to latency, some applications are sensitive to loss of data, some applications are real-time or non-real-time, interactive or non, various kinds of applications are there. So depending on the type of, now we are seeing that quality of service depends on two things. One is type of network and type of applications. Type of network means whether it is connection oriented, circuit switch, packet switch. But now because we are converging everything on internet, network is a given type. Now that variable has gone. Now quality of service of, we are talking only of internet. So now it depends on the applications only. So applications, depending on the application sensitivity though to these five parameters, we can even buy the network for that particular application. If the application expects high quality in certain parameters and not worried about much high quality in other parameters, whether network is able to satisfy his requirements as giving highest priority to those quality of service, like it is giving highest priority to low latency. High latency it cannot tolerate, but some errors it can tolerate, some loss of packets it can tolerate. So like that, depending on application. So application, this is again a repetition, elastic or inelastic. Like elastic applications are file transfer, email messaging, video messaging, audio messaging. So it can tolerate delays, but voice conversation, video calls, video conferencing, that live real-time application, they cannot tolerate delays. This is also just giving examples that tolerance to loss of data. Audio video can tolerate some loss of data, but robot, like you're controlling some robot remotely, you cannot tolerate loss of data. Errors it cannot tolerate. It can give a wrong command to the robot and it may be dangerous. Adaptability of audio is delay adaptive, depending on if they normally provide a buffer at the receiving end so that delay site. Some we'll see in a little while briefly about that. A rate adaptive, as I mentioned, video resolution can be changed based on the throughput available. So what are the issues? Now we have seen that basic internet is not designed, not conceptualized as a network which will carry huge amounts of audio and video, huge amounts of real-time data. It is basically originally designed as a only best effort network. The network says whatever best possible I will do, but I don't guarantee anything. So that kind of network it is. But now it has all such real-time applications, high bandwidth applications have converged onto the onto internet. Now we have to see what can be done, how the bar of best effort can be raised above, how it can be raised to provide all these services to end user. Briefly, we'll see that many of us will be knowing this, that internet follows a layered architecture. It's slightly different from 7-layer architecture, which was produced by IITU, but it's a concept is similar. So I can say there are 4 layers in internet. One is application layer, like what now we are using Zoom. So Zoom is the application layer software. And transport layer is how your Zoom video and audio, how they are divided into small messages and how they are transported. So that is taken care by transport media. Then network understands, here I have drawn a horizontal line here, this network boundary. So network boundary, inside network only IP, internet protocol IP packets are, network recognizes only IP packets. It doesn't recognize what is inside IP packet, whether it is Zoom or Google Meet or whether it is just email, or it doesn't know anything. It just thinks IP packets are all same. So network takes only IP packets as its basic unit. And then on the way, router also treats with IP packets and routes it to further down the line. So network is network boundary is like postbox. You can, when you drop letters in postbox, the post office takes care of only that envelope. It doesn't bother what is inside the envelope. It's a similar concept used here. So as far as network is concerned, you are talking only about IP packets. Now that I have shown here one IP packet in 2 parts. First top part is okay. IP header. Hello? Top part is IP header, and then it is actual content of the packet. So the routers on the way read only the header. It doesn't read the content. It reads the header, which contains source address, destination address, and some other details. We are not going into details of that. So depending on the header only, it keeps on switching and takes the packet to the other end. On conceptually, application talks to application. That means I am using Zoom. All the participants here are using Zoom. So Zoom is talking to Zoom. That is application. But for talking to Zoom, other Zoom, I am using lower layers. So I am dividing my network. Zoom messages, my video, my presentation, everything divided into small messages, and then transport layer handles those messages, converts them into, and those messages may contain audio, mixed thing, audio, video, presentation, PPT, all those things, it is mixed. So that is converted into IP packets and given to the network. So now, as we have seen, internet only handles the IP packets. It doesn't know the contents. And IP, it routes the IP packet. I have shown some network here. Here is one end system and 3 other end systems. And these are the routers. What routers do, each router routes the packet, incoming packet. So this router, when incoming packet comes on this, and then it has to decide whether it has to be sent on this link or this link. And then it routes the packet. So finally, it reaches the destination. So basically, routers exchange the information with other routers, so they get idea of how to switch the packets. We'll see that routers maintain, each router maintains a routing table. Now this routing table keeps on building up depending on the information exchange with other routers. It builds all the routing table, and it knows if incoming packet is coming on this link, which is the best outgoing route at this moment. So it routes the packet on that route. Now our network is very simple, only 8-10 routers are there, but on internet there are lakhs of routers, and each router is having so many links. Maybe every router is having 15 links, 60 links, 64 links. So routing table is very huge there, and all such lakhs of routers working in like an orchestra, working in coordination. So it is a very lot of activities going on in the routing itself. So each router maintains a routing table. It maintains a queue of outgoing packets. For each link, it maintains a separate queue, either one queue or it may be multiple queues also. Like we'll see how what multiple, why multiple queues are required. So the every router, so now we know that every router receives a packet. It refers to the routing table, and depending on the routing table, it sends the puts the packet in outgoing queue or in one of the links, depending on the routing table. And those routing tables are slowly built up using information exchange with other routers. And those routing tables are dynamic. They keep on changing. Maybe every 1 minute is it updated, or some entries are pushed out, some entries are new entries are coming. So continuously it is being updated. So routing table is very dynamic. So you can see right, routing table runs a routing algorithm. There are two kinds of basic algorithms. I'm not going into details of that. Depending on the, basically it takes a overall picture of the network and which is the best route possible and all that. So it selects the best route possible, maintains and frequently updates the routing tables applicable to each ingress link, incoming link. Then switches and forwards the packet, maintains one or more packet queues for each egress link, that is outgoing link. Now there is another concept, multicasting. Now what we are having webinar is the best example of multicasting. I am speaking, I am showing some presentation, and it is going to some 30, 40, 50 destinations. Same packets are going to 50 destinations, let us say. Now, I am sending here, maybe I am sending only one packet from my laptop. I send on, it goes only one packet. Suppose my video, I convert into 100 packets. Packet number one I send. Now, packet number one has to reach 50 destinations. On the way, there is a branching. So maybe some packets have to go this way, some packets have to go that way. So there are two copies will be made. One copy will be sent on one link, other copy will be sent on another link. Like that, it goes on branching. So here I have shown that from beginning, from the source, only one copy of the packet. Here there are two copies going. Then every network, every router, again, there may be a branching. So finally, every receiver will receive packet. So this is called multicasting. Otherwise, if I have to send 50, I would have to transmit 50 packets from here, one packet going to each 50 destinations. So that is called unicast. But it is not efficient way to use unicast. So multicast is used. I am sending only one copy of the every packet. And that copy gets packet gets copied on the way as required if there is a branching. Now there is a delay from one end to other end. Most sensitive point here is a delay for our video. And what contributes to this latency or delay? In the net, there are two sources contributing. Our end systems like my laptop and your laptops or your mobile phones, they themselves contribute to latency, and all the elements on the network also contribute to the latency. Latency means delays. So in network, speed of transmission, if my speed of transmission, I am using low bandwidth, it will take more time to transmit the packet. Propagation delay. So actually there is a distance, this distance from, suppose I one of my recipient here is far away, somewhere 1,000 miles away. There is a propagation delay, which is basically about half of the speed of light on fiber optic cables and wires, slightly more than half, 0.6 times. So that delay is there. Then packet processing time is there. Every router has to read the packet, understand where it has to go. It has to route, put it in the routing table, refer to routing table, put it in the output queue. Then output queue has to actually send it. So all this processing is required. Packet length. If packets are short packets, every router, after it completely receives the packets, it starts sending again. So if packet is long, it has to wait longer to receive the packet and send long. So it sends long, it takes more time. router queues, if queues are building up, it takes more time. End system also processing takes time. If my video audio may be compressed, may be encrypted, there may be some format conversion because I'm not able to show high resolution. I convert high resolution to low resolution or low resolution. I say Zoom or something. And then there is my conversion. So all this cost to delay. Then what can be done? We have to approach at two levels. One is you have to use technologies for reducing the delay or improving the quality of service in both either in end system also and in the routers also. For example, let us take this example of audio communication. We'll come back to this again after a few minutes. But suppose this is an audio source, it is sending audio as a sequence of packets. Now at the receiver, I put a buffer. So the incoming audio, it keeps on putting my packets one by one in the buffer. And this pointer on the buffer keeps on moving horizontally so that at the beginning it is at the right end, and then as the packets keep on coming, it may move less left. And then packets will be delivered to the audio speaker at certain rate or as required for to build up the correct audio. Now, sometimes packet may get delayed, and so buffer may become empty. Sometimes packet may come in a burst, quickly some packets may come, so buffer will get built up. So buffer is a variable quantity which can absorb the variation in delays. It can absorb the jitter, and it can absorb some delay also, because entire audio may get slightly delayed, but I'm adjusting the delay so that user doesn't feel that there is a perceivable delay. User doesn't feel that there is a variation in the delay. So buffer takes care of all these things. Can just increase in the bandwidth of every link in the network do the job? I'm seeing a lot of quality of service. Somebody will say, just put a fiber everywhere, increase the bandwidth, and then nothing is required. Nothing else is required to be done. Once you have high bandwidth, all your data will flow nicely and you don't need any quality of service issues to be tackled. But that is not the case, because many applications adjust their speed of sending to the bandwidth available. If they see that more bandwidth is available, they will start sending more data quickly and all that. So immediately high bandwidth also gets choked up. So increasing bandwidth is definitely useful, but so it is necessary, but not sufficient. There you have to do something else. The key to enable routers. Now you have to enable routers. Yeah, as you have seen, all the routers are basically built up as a best effort. Every packet is independent. I will do my best to forward them. Now you have to overlay something on this network, which original network, so that you can provide high quality. So routers have to, we can say every router treats every packet as independently. We have to slightly deviate from that. You have to identify what is the type of or class of the packet, whether it is audio packet, video packet, or email packet, or what kind of packet you are using. So depending on that, you should be able to give priority. Either identify each flow. Each flow means one source and one destination. A pair forms one flow. One source and other destination, another pair forms another flow. Every flow independently, you can identify and provide some priority to packets on that flow. Or you can identify class of packets and give priorities to certain class of packets. Two methods are used. We'll shortly see that. So two approaches are there. Parameterized systems, where identifies flows. Flow in the, every flow is independently identified, and it is identified by the exchanging some data with the source and destination. And then every flow, all the routers on the way know that this particular flow is flow number such and such. So every packet which comes, it can tag, oh, this belongs to this flow, this belongs to that flow. So every flow is identified. On the other end, second thing is coarse grain, that is prioritized system means I just divide packets in some four or five categories. I just say that packet belongs to category class number one, class number four, class five. Every flow is not identified. So class four is given certain priority, class three is given certain priority. So as a group of packets, you identify. So there are two methods. Now, as we have seen, there are three types. One is best effort service, which can be given to emails and WhatsApp messages, and where there is no guarantee of any bandwidth or any delay. It can tolerate all these things. And then other two are coarse grained, where groups of packets or class of packet is only identified, and fine grained, where individual flows are identified. There are three kinds. We are, of course, for quality of service, we are worried about last two. Best effort, we are not worried about quality of service because it is taken care by the end systems. And so we are worried about this. We look at these two things, coarse grained and fine grained. In fine grained approach, one example which Internet Engineering Task Force has standardized, it's called integrated service, INTSERV. And they developed a protocol called Resource Reservation Protocol, which is a transport layer protocol. As you know, there are our protocol suite on the internet is called TCP/IP. TCP is a transport layer protocol which sits only in the end systems, and IP is a network layer protocol where every router takes care of it. So TCP is a transport protocol. Another transport protocol is UDP. TCP is designed for providing reliable service over unreliable network. Best effort network, but TCP takes care of all the identification of flows and all those things. It takes care errors, everything it takes care. But UDP is another protocol which is a lightweight protocol. It doesn't take care of all these things because some of the applications may not require all those things. So these are two main transport layer protocols being used, TCP and UDP. Now I say that RS, this resource reservation protocol, also is a transport layer protocol because it is a feature of internet layering structure that one transport layer protocol can take services of other transport layers. So RSVP takes care of either TCP or UDP as a final transport layer protocol to send out the packets. So it has developed for integrated service, it has developed this resource reservation protocol, and it identifies certain class of service. Now we'll see how it works. Resource reservation by exchanging request for service, resource requirements, and admission control. So suppose I want to set Zoom conference, I request network that I want to set up such and such service. These are my requirements. I need so much bandwidth, I miss so minimum, maximum delay should be so much, and all that I define. And then network sees whether it is possible to provide this. So it has admission control. If it finds that it is not possible to provide this kind of service, then it refuses the. So it's, sometimes you find that your call doesn't get set up, your video conferencing doesn't get set up because network is not able to support it. Source informs the traffic type and delay, etc., through some specific, and it uses token bucket algorithm. I'll not go into details of this. It gets a token at a fixed rate, and it can tolerate sometimes like ours is a compressed video. See, this video conference uses compressed video, so video rate is not fixed. If my video contains lot of motion, like sports, cricket, and tennis benches, you are observing a lot of movement is there in video, so it generates more data. But if now I am speaking, only my face may be moving or my eye may be moving, but rest all things around me are very steady. So movement in my video is very low, so I don't use so much bandwidth as is used by sports or some movies or something like that. So depending on the data, if I move here, suddenly more data is generated. If I remain steady, low data is generated. So whenever I reduce send low data I accumulate some token, I get some credit of tokens which I can utilize when I have higher data. That is the basic token bucket. I am not going into details of that. Now in RSVP mechanism, suppose this source wants to send packets to these three recipients A, B, and C, then it sends a path request to first router. The first router identifies which is the path that packets can take to all the three destinations, and it goes on building the path information. So at the end, every end system receives entire path which packet has taken. Now, so it knows how packet, which path packets are going, my packets are going to take. Now, what it does, it say asks each router on the way back to the source on the same path that, okay, I want so much bandwidth. It is sent by receiver. This is an important point which you should note, that transmitter or sender doesn't tell how much bandwidth is required. It is the receiver, because quality of service is to be perceived by the receiver. And every receiver may have different requirements. So it is sent by receiver. So it asks every router to reserve certain resource for that. If it is multicast routing, then packets are merged. I will not go more detail, but just as we have seen multicasting from left to right, packets will go on being copied, while right to left packets will go on getting merged. I'm assuming that left is a source and right ones are destinations. RSVP, this mechanism, I showed, is not done only once. Now we are having video conferencing, I'm giving a talk for say 45 minutes or 1 hour. Then it is not that once I set up all this resource reservation, it remains steady for 45 minutes or one hour. Every half a minute it is updated. So, and if for 3 minutes it is not updated, it will time out and call may get dropped also. So that is, it is very dynamic. Now you will understand that on internet at this particular time, lakhs of people may be watching videos and attending lectures or working from home. So everybody needs, if every flow is identified and every half a minute its bandwidth is reserved and turned down and all that, so much activity goes on. So this kind of working, RSVP kind of working, it cannot scale up. It cannot go to very high volumes. So although it may be used for certain applications, it is not very widely used because it is not very scalable. So there is another method which we have seen, that coarse grain. Instead of treating every individual flow as a separate flow, we have to identify group of flows, we have to aggregate of flows. So although I mentioned that originally IP network and internet IP network was designed as a best effort network, but designers had some foresight and they had reserved one 8-bit field for type of service. That time it was not being used, but somehow somebody thought had a good foresight and he kept some 8 bits reserved for type of service. And for almost 20 to 30 years, this field was almost unused. Nobody was using. Only when audio, video, and real-time content went on increasing, people thought, oh, now this field is lying vacant. I can make use of this field for my audio video applications. So this is what they have started using for coarse grain. So this 8-bit field is divided into two parts, 6 bits for what they call diffs. This is called differentiated service, like earlier one, identification of separate flows, that was called integrated services. This is called differentiated service. So code point means just class you can identify. Some name is very formal name is given, but it means what is the class of that packet. And depending on the class, whether it is class number 3 or 4, then priority can be given. 2 bits are reserved for what they call explicit congestion notification. That means if network is experiencing some high traffic and congestion, it feels that I may not be able to carry this much video traffic, then it in advance it shows to indicates to the source and destination, oh, there is some congestion in the network, be careful, I may not be able to handle your traffic. Then source and destination may try to reduce the resolution of the video, so that they call congestion avoidance. So congestion is avoided by giving a warning signal that congestion is coming and you may better reduce the bandwidth requirement. So that part we'll leave it at that. So what we are bothered now about is this 6 bits, which convey, and there are two types of classes mainly are used, expedited forward and assured forwarding, EF and AF. Now comes into picture what is called as per hop behavior. That means what every router will do. Every router is a one hop. So what every router will independently do without depending on other routers, when a packet comes to the router, it has to take some decision what it will do. That is called per hop behavior. So now it has to see the what is the policy of that router, what is the policy of the network, that admin domain or autonomous sources domain. So what is the policy of that network? Depending on that, it has to manage the packet. So it may put, as I told, every output link may have multiple queues, like Tirupati temple, you are having multiple queues. One who pays more is put in a shorter queue, one who pays less is put in a longer queue. So like that, one who packet which has to get higher priority is put in some different queue, which may be a shorter in length, and it is given higher priority to send. So like that, multiple queues may be mentioned. So depending on the policy of the network, policy of the router and resources available in the network, it may decide, okay, this is the class of the packet. Packet class has to be decided by the first router. Even source may decide it, but every router has got authority to change depending on its own resources. So depending on the class of that 8-bit field, which by foresight they have reserved, those with the 6 bits out of that, it defines the class, and depending on the class, it may identify different queues and you may give priorities. So if a packet comes to a router, by default, it is a best efforts. It puts in some common queue, maybe Tirupati temple visit without any free visit without any payment. So it puts in that queue by default. But if somebody has paid more, that means it has given higher priority, then it may treat it as expedited service. So which is having low delay, priority queuing, low loss, admission control and policing are effective. Admission control means if it is, as we have seen, if network is not able to provide this traffic, it may just reject the call. And whether it is sending at that rate or it is sending more. So it will do that. Assured services for particular packets, it will give definite bandwidth. Okay, all these much still higher priority. In assured service, you have to assure the delivery, and four classes with differing priority. Even within assured, what is called weighted fair queuing is used. That means they are put in different queues. Every queue is given weightage. So if higher priority queue will be given higher weightage, suppose that weightage is 4, other weightage is 2, and a third weightage is 1. If first 4 packets of one queue may go, then 2 packets of other queue, 1 packet of other third one. So like that, priorities are given. And packet drop selection means if suppose worst case time comes that some packets have to be dropped, we cannot transmit, then how, which packets to drop, that decision also, assured packets are as far as possible not dropped. Now we have seen that what routers can do. Routers can provide two types of services, either fine grained, which identifies every flow separately and treats the every flow separately, and coarse grained, which finds only class of flow, class of packet, and gives priorities based on the class. Now at the end, what end systems can do? Most of the systems today, like Zoom or Google Meet, these are proprietary systems. They don't reveal all the secrets of their app which they are using. But to some extent, we know that most of them are using real-time protocol, RTP, which is part of application layer. And then that protocol can detect that packets are lost, and it has to somehow make up and put up a presentable video. It compensates jitter, and it's sequences out of sequence packets. And there is a control protocol also, real-time control protocol, which sends a feedback to source. Okay, I am not receiving your video properly. So source may adjust, reduce its bandwidth and all that. So these protocols are being used. Then, as I told, there are two fundamental transport layer protocols. One is TCP and another is UDP. TCP is used by these video conferencing applications for overall session control, like basic giving some commands. And UDP is used for actual audio and video media. So RTP, RTCP is used for actual streaming. So RTP, RTCP uses UDP and then sends the video audio. There is another protocol, RTSP, like when you are watching movies, sometimes you want to pause, you want to play like you do on video DVD player or something. So though, for those commands, then there is a web RTC protocol which is being used, or HTML5, whether this video, Zoom video, if you may be having Zoom app with you, so you may be watching on Zoom app, or you may watch it in browser also, Google Meet or other things also, you can watch in a browser also, Chrome or Microsoft Edge or something, you can use browser. So to enable the browsers to show these videos and audios, they use these protocols. Then they may be using encryption for media also and for data also. So all these things are done in the end systems. Now, while doing all these things, it has to take required quality of service into account. This end systems do all these functions like encryption. It may use use browser, it may use app, or it may use various controls, play, call, pause, and all those things. But at the same time, while doing all these functions, it has to see that it doesn't degrade the quality of service in terms of delay, in terms of bandwidth, in terms of loss of packets. On the other hand, it has to make up something. It has to lost packets, it has to fill the gaps and put up presentable video and all those things it has to do. So what end applications also play a good role in that. Now we come to the last part of our talk. All these things we have seen, what as far as network is concerned, what are the parameters on the network which you can see quality of service like delay and other things. These are the measurable parameters. But finally, whether your quality of service was achieved or not, users only can decide. Now, for example, when you use Zoom or Google Meet or Geo Meet or anything, in the end, they ask you, you put your experience on scale of 4 or 5. If it is 4, they will ask the reason why it is low. You are given a low rating. So it is they get a feedback from the users. And that is very important thing, that they actually see how user has perceived the quality of service, not in terms of technical parameters like loss of packets and bandwidth. These are all technical things, which are measurable things. But how user has perceived, it is very important. So that is done through some feedback. Now, there are various ways. This mean opinion score is a very old method which was used in telephone, but it was used as a testing setup. Means some 100 users, they were involved in some tests, and somebody used to speak, and every user sitting at very different places then finally has to make a score out of 5, you know, on how the audio, whether audio was distorted, noise was there, echo was there, video clearly audible, you can make out what person was speaking, or it was very hard to make out what person was speaking. Based on that, the 4 or 5 parameters, every parameter you have to mark scale of 5, and then they used to collect the method. So this was a very old method used in old telephone networks also. Even today it is very relevant. There are other methods also used: perceptual speech quality, perceptual video quality, and overall quality of experience. These are the 3-4 standard methods used. There are two ways these methods are used. One is, as we have seen, actually users are asked to give a feedback. That is one method. Second method is, at the receiver, you put some electronic equipment. That equipment will check the quality of video or audio which is being received, and then generate its feedback. So either feedback is auto-generated or generated by human 1B. These are two methods used. So now we come to the end of our lecture. Let's just recap in 2 minutes. All the communication applications have converged on the internet today. Users from multimedia to real-time control expect certain performance from internet in terms of quality of service. Of course, what quality of service parameters are seen, users don't know loss of packet and all those technical things. They will say, oh, audio, video was not good, video was getting frozen, audio was getting broken, and all. They express in these terms. But finally, you have to translate this user experience into technical parameters of loss of packet, delay, and all those things. As a network engineering part, you have to translate user experience into measurable parameters. So quality of service features have been overlaid onto original best effort network in two ways. One is integrated service and differentiated service. In integrated service, the preferences are set on per flow basis. What is flow? One pair of sender and receiver makes one flow. So integrated service sets preferences per flow basis, reserving resources all the en route routers. While in differentiated service sets the preference for aggregate based on their class. So differentiated service is the most used method along with the some techniques used in end system also. In end system algorithms also do certain kind of work on improving quality of service. So I think I'll thank all of you for patient listening, and my talk is over, and I hand over the mic to the college.
Yes, sir. Very much thankful for giving such a fantastic knowledge about the networking and all these things. Now we will start with the question and answer session, because we got very much question in our chat box. So yeah, Anushka will ask. Anushka will ask one by one question.
Right.
Because students are getting very, very much interest because they are having the online mode. So they are thinking about that. What are the difficulties they are facing in their streaming? Now they understand the technical aspects.
Right.
What is the actual funda in that delay and streaming? Anushka, please start.
Thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful session. It was truly very nice. We have a first question from Rahul Belani. He's asking, sir, can you explain again the throughput?
Can you repeat that? Can you explain?
Sir, can you explain again throughput?
Throughput. Throughput is how much data is transmitted or sent from one place to other place per second. So it depends on bandwidth. It also depends on how much is processing can be handled by our routers and all that. But bandwidth is one part of it. But finally, throughput comes to what is the say per second, so many megabytes are sent from one end to other end. That is the throughput.
We again have next question from Rahul Belani itself.
Yes.
He's asking, can you explain again the packet delay jitter?
Packet delay is delay it takes from packet from sender to reach to the receiver. Suppose it takes 50 milliseconds or something like that. That delay is who contributes to that delay is actually the processing time of the sender itself. Suppose video is there. Now video is getting compressed and encrypted. Then it takes time. Then actual packet size takes time, because every router completely receives the packet and then only starts sending at the outgoing. So time it takes to receive the packet also contributes to that delay. And actual propagation time, you know, on the fiber cables or copper cables, the electronic signals travel at about 0.6 times the speed of light. So if you are going from here to USA, you will feel that propagation delay also becomes important. And end system, receiving end also decompresses, decrypts all that. So these are the major contributions. And if traffic network is congested, lot of time packet may be just lying in the queue. So all these things add to the delay. So this is delay, and also called as latency. Have you ever tried TRAI test method? Now, our telecom regulatory authority of India, they give one app on your broadband network at home, or say we can test the speed and other things. So if you run the test, it will give result in terms of how much bandwidth you have got and how much latency you have experienced. So latency is actually this delay, which is end-to-end delay for packet from starting from one end to reach at the other end. Now the jitter is variation in the delay. If delay is not fixed, it keeps on varying. So depending on the congestion, depending on some route it takes, the delay keeps on varying. Now when you are sending a video, you have to receive a video or audio in a continuous flow. You cannot tolerate. So if some part of video is reaches after 1 second, another part reaches after 2 seconds, then you may receive, see the gap. So at the receiving end, what they see, maximum delay is 2 seconds. Sometimes it is 1 second, but it is it doesn't go beyond 2 seconds. So it itself puts a buffer of say some another two second buffer, so that if first packet comes quickly, it is delivered quickly. Last packets which gets delayed is put in the buffer. So although packets which are input to the buffer, they may come in varying time, output to the buffer is given as steady rate. So that is taken a delay jitter. So jitter is variation in the latency. Delay is end-to-end delay is latency, and jitter is variation in the latency.
Sir, I have a small announcement.
Yes.
Requesting everyone to please fill in the feedback form. It is posted in the chat box below. So we have next question from Sandhya ma'am. Explain the QoS concept in some easy language, understanding QoS, language.
Yeah. QoS is the quality of service you get from the network. So network is offering a certain service of communication, either communicating video or audio or real time, and you expect certain quality that, okay, now this quality of service is at two levels. One is actual user level. User will see my video was not good. It was getting frozen. It is getting some squares I was receiving. Audio was very broken, or audio quality was not good. Some words are getting dropped. I'm not understanding. All such things. This is a quality of service as experienced by user in a common man language. So he expects that my video should be continuous and nice looking. My audio should be straight, very audible, very understandable, as if the person is sitting in front of me. So all video and audio, he expects that as if the person is sitting in front of him. That is the quality of service he expects. But sometimes he may settle for a lower quality. Okay, some low quality video because it's only one face angle to see. Like I don't need much very high quality, I can settle for low. So what quality of service user experiences. Now, as a network engineer, he has to translate this quality of service into technical parameters. And those technical parameters come down in terms of bandwidth or throughput, how many packets per second he is able to receive, whether packets are getting delayed, whether packets that delay is steady, fixed or varying, whether packets are getting dropped, or packets are some errors are coming because of during the transmission, wrong packets are received. Packets are made up of one and zeros. So ones are getting changed to zero and zero is changing to one. Some such errors are popping up. So network engineer has to understand user perception, which he has expressed in a common man's language, into these technical terms. So as far as user is concerned, quality of service is, I want steady and video and audio, nice video and very understandable, easy, loud audio and very nicely sounding audio. When user gives a feedback, audio was not good, video was not good, network engineer has to translate that not good into the in terms of loss of packets, delay and throughput.
Next question is from Athira. what is data storm and how can we minimize it?
Data storm is the same thing that suddenly very large amount of data in a burst, everybody starts sending a burst, and then it keeps on looping also. So suddenly huge amount of data is generated. It is not a steady thing like traffic jams. So a lot of traffic is suddenly coming. So you have to take, now as I explained, congestion avoidance, one is protocol. If that is one thing is being done, that like we see in Google Maps, Google Map tell, oh, this road is having congestion. So we avoid that road and go on other road. This is congestion avoidance. So similar thing is done in network, that sources are informed that there is a congestion, so they take some corrective action. If it is not possible, only thing network can do is the drop packets. Nothing else can be done.
So we have next question from Krisha Chadwa. What are the contents of seven-layered architecture?
Internet architecture, we have seen four layers: application, transport, IP layer, and hardware layer. Now, in the seven-layer architecture, application layer is split into three parts. One is actual application, actually app which we are using, like Zoom or something. Second part is presentation, which is part which does the compression and encryption or format conversion and language conversion, all such things. So basic, your video is coming of one quality, then the presentation layer will convert it into certain things which can be easily transmitted. Thirdly is session layer. Session layer, rather it is half in application layer, half in transport layer. But session layer establishes a session. Now we are having this Zoom conference. So we are setting up a session. Now for 1 hour or 1.5 hours, we have set up a session. I am speaking, and that session is continuing for 1.5 hours. And if I now we stop video conferencing, tomorrow some other lecture is there, we'll set up another session. So for every sending, like suppose you have to transfer a large file, then you set up a session, transmit the file in terms of say hundreds of thousands of packets, and when entire file is transferred, end the session. So that is session layer. Now in internet, presentation layer is merged in application layer, so application itself is taking care of presentation. Session layer is halfway, half of the job. If session layer is done in application, half is done in this transport layer if it is a TCP. So in TCP, half of the session identifying the flows, identifying adjusting the rate of flow of data, and all those things are done in the TCP. So in internet protocol, there are two layers: application and transport layer. While in seven-layer protocol, these two layers are split into four layers: application, presentation for compression and translation, encryption and such thing, session for setting up session, and then actual transport layer. Now bottom two layers, IP layer and hardware layer. Their IP layer, similar concept is there in seven layer also. Hardware layer, it is split into two parts: logical link layer, like actual format of the link layer structure, and then actual hardware layer. Here both are in internet, we see both as single layer, but their hardware layer, for example, if you are using Ethernet, then Ethernet packet structure, what is the header of Ethernet, that becomes logical layer, logical link layer, and then actual transmission electrical signals become hardware layer. While internet, these two layers are merged. So in internet, bottom two layers are becoming three layers, and top three two layers are becoming four layers. And there are other differences, like you can have multiple protocols in one layer, and one protocol can call service of other protocol in the same layer, which is not allowed in seven layer structure.
Anushka asks now last question.
Sir, what are the job opportunities with respect to networking in government sector?
Government government sector, there are good job opportunities because government sector is more worried about security of the communication. Other than communication, more and more government sector is standing to use their dedicated network links rather than depend on internet. Of course, everybody is using, government also uses for their talking to other people, talking to public. They have to use internet, and but they are using their own secure networks among themselves. They, especially defense services and other things, atomic energy, they want to use their own network. And so government, mostly the job of network engineers are required for such thing. I don't say they are required in very large volumes, but job is very critical in the sense, it is not only internet and common, security becomes very, very important, and interconnectivity between internet and security.